A little bit of competition, since trash is a very big issue evidently in the city of San Angelo. I live in the country with a 4-yard, so I just fill that dude up and don't have the issues y'all seem to have inside the city limits. So we do have a big trash meeting, but I'm grateful for your being here. This is the third in our series of The Truth About. Tonight we're going to discuss Obamacare. I'm David Curry, Chair of the Tom Green County Democratic Party. And we've tried to find, I do not know, our speaker, John Hawkins, before tonight. I don't know his politics. I do know he is in charge of government relations for the Texas Hospital Association. He's a graduate of the University of Texas. He's a Baylor fan, that's all I'm going to say about that. Since four of our top recruits just went there because we had a little mix-up at the school and communicating problems or something. Which were really bad problems, by the way. Talk a little louder, Drew. Okay, I'll hold it closer. But we want John to talk. The reason we're doing these things, folks, is we all have questions about a lot of things. The next one's gonna be on Social Security and Medicare. And then it'll be on public education. And then it's gonna be on voter ID. But there's nothing been more controversial, probably, than the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare. And if you listen to politicians, you hear either it's the greatest thing ever done, if you're a Democrat, generally speaking, and I'm not sure about that. My values, everyone that knows me knows my values come from my faith. I have a PhD from Southwestern Seminary in Christian Ethics. And to me, the idea of 20 million more people or 16 million or whatever it is having health insurance fits my values. So I like that. I also hear folks say their insurance went way up. Texas Farmers Union, of which I'm a part of, and not the Farm Bureau, sent a letter out saying they could no longer provide health care through their program any longer. And it said specifically because of Obamacare. So we all have questions. What I want to stress is we all need to get back to the day where we sit down and talk about things. Obamacare passed without a single Republican vote. That's horrible. It has been voted to be repealed 50 times. That's equally horrible. If it needs fixing, then fix it. And John, talk to us about how to fix it, how to make it better. There's nothing in the world that's all black and all white. We're all working with grays. We're all working with the best of our abilities. And we need people working with the best of their abilities, not in partisan politics, but in helping our communities and our state. And John's working to do that for our Texas hospitals. We all know, as a cancer survivor here, we are truly blessed to have the healthcare systems we have in San Angelo, Texas. They are outstanding. And so I'm thrilled that John Hawkins drove all the way from Austin. His friend is here with him. Where's that young man? Lance? I've got a son named Lance. Lance is here with Texas Hospital Association as well. Thank you for coming up, and I'm going to turn it over to John. And John, give us 20, 25 minutes, and then there'll be lots of questions, I'm sure, and there are no questions off limits, as long as you're nice. That's my rule. I tell people when I build them a house, I have two rules. Be nice and have fun. We apply the same rules to all our meetings. Be nice and have fun. John, thank you for being here.
Yeah. Well, thank you all for having me, and again, you know, love coming to San Angelo. Many of y'all may know that our former CEO of the Texas Hospital Association was actually Dr. Dan Stoltz, who ran Practice of Medicine here in town and ran Shannon. So Dan is a great guy. Certainly appreciate what he did for this community and what he did for THA. Let me tell you a little bit about THA. We're the statewide trade association. We're located in Austin. We've got about 500 hospitals that are our members. Those are urban hospitals, rural hospitals, West Texas, South Texas, all over the state. They're public hospitals, not-for-profit, Shannon would be here, and investor-owned, like the community hospital here as well. So all different types. Lance and my job is to try to keep all those guys on the same page so we can give a unified message to the legislature and to Congress about what's important for hospitals. So I saw the article in the paper and appreciate the title of the presentation. I'm going to take a little bit different tact. When I do these things, I don't necessarily want to get into a debate about what's good and what's not good in Obamacare, but really the message I want to give you, and I think the intro was right on point, is this is too important of an issue for this country for us not to get it right. And I think you teed it up well. What really needs to happen is for Congress to come together, both sides of the aisle, and fix this thing. Because the premise, and I'm going to lay that out, I think is still solid. It's just some of the financials of it and some of the timing of the way things rolled out is what's really the problem. So why is it important that we focus on this in the first place? And a lot of people ask why the president chose this as the first thing to work on, especially when he knew it would be something that's very divisive. And the reality is, healthcare costs are unsustainable in this country. And you probably all know that because you're dealing with those. I'm sure we could have, stay here till midnight, all with an individual horror story about the cost of healthcare. But we spend about $8,500 annually per capita compared to about $4,300 in other industrialized countries. So that's about 18% of our gross domestic product that's going to healthcare. By 2020, that's probably going to be 20%. And what that does is it reduces resources that can go to other worthwhile programs. The debate we hear in Austin is, money we're spending on healthcare is not money we can spend on public education, higher education, roads, and water. Those are all very important things. We have limited resources. And it reduces our competitiveness globally. I'm sure, many of the industries in this town are they're not dealing with statewide competitors or U.S. competitors anymore. They are dealing with global competitors. And I just laid out how most other countries spend a lot less on healthcare than we do. The other thing that's unfortunate is, so we spend $8,500 per capita, we ought to get something really good for that. And I think, we do have generally really good healthcare in this country, if you have insurance, really good specialty care. But the reality is, when you look at a lot of the outcomes in our healthcare system, birth outcomes, a lot of just the primary care type outcomes, we actually fare worse than a lot of the rest of the country. The other issue is obviously the federal budget situation. And great, it looks like you're going to have a couple other sessions coming up, which I think are very important as well. Because the other thing you hear a lot of noise about when people talk about they want to be, deficit hawks or work on the debt is, we need to deal with the National Education Agency or foreign aid or, this, that, and the other. The reality is, if you're not talking about Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security, you're not talking about reducing the federal deficit, because those outlays are about two-thirds of the federal budget. The other big one is obviously defense, which, we need to have that in place as well. So if you're talking about deficit reduction, you got to talk about these entitlement programs, and that can be very difficult when you're going forward. And when you look at those entitlement programs, particularly Medicare compared to Social Security has actually remained fairly flat, and there's some actuarial things we could do to true that up. But the Medicare line and the Medicaid line, to some extent, are what's really killing us, because again, these healthcare costs keep going up for a variety of reasons. So here's the deal. If you're going to fix the healthcare system, it's very complex, a lot of different actors in it, and so you need to do about 10 different things. You can't just do one thing. When the majority party in Congress right now says they want to repeal the law and just allow you to buy insurance across state lines, it isn't going to work. It's not that simple. There's many other levers that need to be addressed, and that's what Obamacare attempted to do. And remember, we kind of had a walkthrough of this back when Clinton was president. Actually, Hillary headed that effort up. That failed for a variety of reasons, but Tom Daschle was in the Senate, and he was instrumental in that whole process, and he really saw what you know, what made that fail in the end. And the reality was, it was that none of the providers were bought into this, so they could fight it, and that's what ultimately killed it. So here's what you got to do. You got to have insurance reform where insurance companies can't choose to only cover folks that are generally healthy. And that's the system we had before, because if you had pre-existing conditions, if you hit your lifetime maximum, you basically, the insurance companies could choose not to write you insurance. You got to create some mandate or incentive, financial incentive, for everyone to play. Because and I'm going to talk about EMTALA in a minute, if you create a system where people don't play but can still go to a hospital and get care, that doesn't work either, because guess what? They're not going to pay a premium if they know there's a safety net. You have to reform the payment system. Before Obamacare, we had a system, a fee-for-service system, which my old boss used to call eat what you kill, not necessarily politically correct, but everybody got paid separately, doctors, hospitals, pharmacies, nursing homes, and guess what? If you get paid to provide more medical care, what are you going to do? You're going to provide more medical care. And you're not going to provide it in an integrated fashion, because each of those parties has an incentive to just manage their part of the place. You got to change the benefit design. And a lot of this is entitlement reform. When you're talking about means testing Medicare or moving to more of a premium support in Medicare, one of the problems we have is when we rolled out HMOs and companies really, again, because of global wage competition, started providing benefits in lieu of salaries, we all went to a system where everybody had $10 copays and $4 pharmaceuticals, as opposed to the old days where we had, major medical, basically. You paid most things out of pocket. You might have gotten some discount based on volume, but really your insurance policy was to provide catastrophic care. No different than auto insurance. You don't expect your auto insurance to change your oil and your windshield wipers. But somehow in healthcare, we expect to be able to go get a medical procedure and pay $10. We expect to get a pharmaceutical and pay $4. Guess what? We removed what we call skin in the game. Now, if my son sprains his ankle playing football, if it's a $10 copay, I'm like, he needs an MRI. We actually have a health savings account at THA now, so it gives me an incentive to manage that health savings account. So if he sprains his ankle and the bone's not sticking out, I'm going to say, hey, put that thing on ice overnight. If it's still not working in the morning, then we'll go seek medical care. So through benefit design, we've really removed the consumer from making choices about their health care. And from the provider side, we don't do a good job because of that system of actually telling you what things cost, what our quality is, so you can actually shop around and see what's better. So, we've got a stake in this as well. You got to change the way individuals consume health care. Personal responsibility. Saw a presentation a couple months ago where the presenter said one of the problems in the U.S. is because we have such great medicine, because we have such great pharmaceuticals, we expect that we can live a pretty poor lifestyle, and then at the end, medicine's going to swoop in and fix it all. And that's just not the reality. So obviously, what's going on with diabetes and some of these other issues, those lifestyle choices impact the cost of healthcare over the long term. Reduce waste. And when I talk about waste, not talking about fraud and abuse, talking about evidence-based medicine. We do a lot of things in medicine, again, because in the old days we got paid to do it, that when you look at peer-reviewed studies amongst the medical professionals, don't measurably increase quality of life versus the cost that it actually is to provide that care. So again, part of Obamacare is to change the payment system where you create shared savings models where providers actually work together to reduce the cost of healthcare, because they're actually going to share in that savings. They're going to share it with the beneficiary. They're going to share it amongst themselves. in the current system, if doctor goes to the hospital administrator and says, hey, I think we ought to use this lower cost implantable, if you try to share the savings, it's actually illegal. It's called the anti-kickback statute. And it was appropriate fee for service, but not in the new system. And if we actually got together and created lower cost care, who gets the money? The insurance company gets the money. Under a shared savings model, you create lower cost care, the providers get some of the money, the beneficiaries get some of the money as well. So you actually retool the incentives, which is important. And the final one, and again, this they try to talk about this and when they pass the act, is end-of-life care. We do a really poor job of managing end-of-life care in this country. European countries use hospice care a lot more aggressively, palliative care a lot more aggressively than we do in this country. Again, in the old system, a lot better for the hospital to keep people in the ICU and bill Medicare as opposed to having them in a lesser level of care. Remember, they tried to talk about this, tried to pay doctors to actually do counseling about end-of-life care, and the debate turned into death panels, which was not productive. But again, when you look at a lot of those European countries that have lower per capita costs in healthcare, it's because they deal with end-of-life a lot better. So let me talk a little bit about EMTALA, if any of you have heard of that, Emergency Medical Treatment and Active Labor Act. So this is the law that basically says any federal law says any hospital has to stabilize and treat to some level anyone that presents in an emergency room, regardless of the ability to pay. So again, you talk about principles. We as a country, because there were horrible cases of hospitals actually dumping patients at another hospital because they didn't have insurance, they were dying on the street, frankly, we said, we're better than that. Guess who signed that law? Ronald Reagan. So that was a Republican president in a Budget Reconciliation Act, which everybody hates Obamacare because it was done in a Budget Reconciliation Act. But because of those cases that were in the media, Reagan signed that because we, again, said, we're not going to stand for that. The problem is we never figured out a way to finance that. And so that's created an issue right now, particularly in a state like Texas with 25% uninsured. It's also important to think about when that was signed, it frankly guaranteed, universal health care coverage. Again, not debated in when they passed Obamacare, because most members of Congress know that's a third rail. You don't want to talk about potentially dying care to folks. Even Trump, early on when he was talking about Medicaid expansion, and I think Cruz pressed him on whether or not he would support the Medicaid expansion in Obamacare, he said, well, we're going to have to figure something out because we're, as a country, aren't going to let people die on the street. I mean, even he recognized that as an important point. So I think we need to remember that, that we've created that principle. What it also does, if we don't have insurance reform and financial incentives or disincentives, either through the tax code or otherwise, you just create a huge safety valve for folks to not necessarily do the right thing. So why is it important to deal with the uninsured? So again, we've created this safety valve under EMTALA. I'd argue it's the right thing to do. But why am I here today? Because hospitals are the one that get to pay for that. So right now in Texas, Texas hospitals are reporting at least $5.5 billion a year in uncompensated healthcare costs to the state. And so, those are costs that are unreimbursed. And so how does that get paid for? Well, if you live in Bexar County, Travis County, Dallas County, where you've got a hospital district, local taxpayers are picking up some level of that because the public hospital has to cover that uninsured cost through their tax levy. If you're not in an area with a public hospital, then that cost is getting shifted onto the private market. So in Texas, it's estimated that about $1,800 a year in a family premium is actually paid to cover the cost of the uninsured. So that's a hidden tax, basically. And that's what we've argued, is it's better to expand coverage, pay for it up front, give us a chance to better manage that care, because we could potentially give folks some tax relief if they're in an area with a public hospital, and it would also help stabilize the cost of private market health insurance. So, Affordable Care Act, again, you know, sought to do insurance reform, basically, you know, not allow insurance companies to have lifetime limits, pre-existing conditions, hold them to medical loss ratios, so they actually have to pay out the majority of their money in premiums and not to administrative costs. It moves us more to a quality-based payment system, which I'll talk a little bit about more in the past, or in the future. So in return for that, it said we're going to create an individual mandate, only fair to you insurance company. If we're going to make you write insurance for everybody, we're going to require them to have insurance. And we're going to do that through the tax code. So I think we could debate, you know, whether that's the best way to do it, or whether that ought to be linked to still to employer-sponsored coverage, or delinked, as a lot of the Republicans have said. But the reality is, if you don't require people to have coverage, then it's called adverse selection. The folks that don't have, that are generally healthy, won't buy coverage, and then the insurance companies will be just left with sicker folks, and that's what causes premium spikes. And you got a little of that going on right now, because I would argue the tax penalty is so low, we still got a lot of people going uninsured, and so that's what's driving some of the spiking out there. So we said everybody's got to have coverage. Obviously, healthcare coverage in the private market is too expensive, particularly for the working poor folks between like 138 to 400% of federal poverty. And so we need to create a way to subsidize that. We want those people to have private market insurance, but we need to help them to purchase that. And so that's what created the exchange. About half of that, folks below 138% of poverty were to be covered under the expanded Medicaid program in the state, which after the Supreme Court ruling, the state legislature has not chosen to do that. Now, other states have come along, Arkansas, Indiana, and said, all right, we don't want to expand the entitlement program. Let's just put the Medicaid population in the private market exchange as well. Just give them a deeper subsidy, and we think that's very important as well. So I'll explain this to a lot of members of the legislature, and they'll say, well, you know, even if they agree with the premise of requiring everybody to have insurance, just like your auto insurer does, and or your lien holder on your auto, your lien holder on your house requires you to have insurance, if we're going to require people to do that and we're going to subsidize it, isn't that just adding to the federal deficit? And this is really where I fault the administration, because they haven't done a good job, or members of Congress that voted for this bill, about explaining the financing of Obamacare. So the bill is actually paid for. The Congressional Budget Office, bipartisan, said that it's paid for. It's about a $1 trillion bill over 10 years. About half a trillion comes from increased revenue, Medicare tax increase on high earners, Cadillac tax on high-value health plans, a device tax, a tanning bed tax of all things. But the other half a trillion, and this is where it's important to hospitals, is actually cuts to providers. So when the Medicare trustees come out and say Obamacare extended the life of Medicare by 11 years, a lot of that is because they're taking half a trillion out of the system to help finance this. So people say, well, why did you guys make that deal? Well, the reality is those cuts were already in the president's budget. They were in Simpson-Bowles. Because again, from a deficit reduction standpoint, we knew we had to manage down the cost of outlays for healthcare. So from a hospital perspective, we know those cuts are coming one way or another. We would rather deal with them in a rational fashion under something like Obamacare, where we're trying to expand coverage, because that gives us time to re-engineer ourselves. And we can offset some of those cuts with coverage because of that uncompensated care that's out there. So it's important to know that, you know, when folks are talking about all this money and the subsidies, is they are finance. It's about $16 billion over 10 years and cuts just the hospitals to help finance that, that coverage expansion, about $155 billion. And it's cuts to Medicare Advantage, so that's the health plans. It's cuts to nursing homes, pharmaceuticals, pretty much everybody that, that plays in the Medicare game. So I think that that's important going forward. The other big thing that's not talked about a lot in Obamacare are is the payment reform. And I think this is very important. And again, this is the thing that's really going to help us manage the cost curve on healthcare going forward. The problem is it's going to take a while until we start seeing some of these things manifest itself. So basically, what the bill does is it directs the payment agency, CMS they call it, which pays for Medicare and Medicaid, to basically create a pay-for-performance system as opposed to a fee-for-service system that actually moves us to care based on quality and actually creates shared savings where it's in our interest to create lower cost models of care. Create incentives for preventive care versus acute care. Penalize hospitals for medical errors that are under our control, which just costs the healthcare system more money. Penalize us for readmissions that are under our control. If your auto mechanic does a bad job on your car and you have to go back, you don't expect to have to pay for that again. Under fee-for-service, if we did a bad job on discharge, mess that hand up off from pharmaceutical, home health, whatever, they got back in the hospital, great, we just keep billing Medicare. That system is changing now. And then moving to more of an evidence-based system where you actually get integrated teams of caregivers together to actually look at medical care that actually is high quality, lower cost, and actually makes sense. And again, I think that's important. So I'm going to wrap up here so we have plenty of time for questions. So, what do we need to focus on beyond just the insurance reform, trying to make coverage more affordable, and the payment reform? And obviously, I think I've talked a little bit about it. Personal responsibility, I think, is very important. And you can do that a lot of different ways. A lot of it's benefit design, creating things like health savings account, where if folks actually do the right things on preventive care, lifestyle choices, they can actually share in the savings from that. We need to get serious about transparency, about showing you how much things cost and what the quality and value of those, what those are, and I think that's important. Entitlement reform. I know you're going to talk a little bit about this in subsequent meetings, but you can't just keep cutting providers. There has to be reform on the beneficiary side of the equation as well. And again, this is, I'll actually credit somebody like Paul Ryan, who's tried to get out in front of some of these things, which are sometimes politically unpopular. But it's pretty easy to true up some of these systems from an actuarial standpoint. Not so easy politically. Social Security, you got to look at raising the retirement age. Most of these programs were created when life expectancy was much lower, and so the delta of what we thought we were actually going to be paying for was much less. Medicare, we need to look at, I would argue, at means testing, and again, you can do that in a smart way where you're not cutting people off from care. Medicaid, I think the federal government needs to give the state more flexibility on how we administer our Medicaid program. In Medicare, I think, is really, there's lots of misconceptions about Medicare, and you have a lot of that. You saw that when they passed Obamacare, when folks said, we don't want government-run health care, not knowing that Medicare is actually a government-run program, where folks will say, you can't mess with the financing of that. I've paid in that system all my life. Well, guess what? Average couple pays about $122,000 over their lifetime in Medicare taxes, but receives $387,000 in benefits. Wow. And here's the scary thing. We're adding 8,000 people a day into that upside down system because of the baby boomers. So again, that's something we can't be scared to be talking about, because actuarially, that system does not work, and you can't just cut providers to get there. I tell members of Congress all the time, it doesn't do any good to tell, you know, seniors that you're protecting Medicare if you're cutting physician payments on the other side and you don't have a network of providers to actually provide that care. And it's really getting more acute on the physician side as well. And then again, looking at the benefit structure, you know, I know there's supplemental plans, first dollar coverage, I would argue first dollar coverage is not the best thing for driving behavior on healthcare utilization. Again, sometimes a tough thing to talk about. So again, I think it's gonna be a great debate in the future, but we gotta get serious about Medicare and Social Security. And I think those are, kind of the last thing, you know, I'll talk about is just, I've talked about end of life care. Liability reform, I think, is important as well. We've done a lot on that in Texas. Another idea that's out there is, again, talking about having the college, each college of medicine come together and actually themselves determine best practices, evidence-based care within their specialty. They ought to get a safe harbor from getting sued if they use those practice standards. We do a lot of stuff in medicine right now because extra tests get ordered, extra procedures get done because folks are afraid they might get sued if they haven't taken every means possible. And again, I think it's the right idea, but it's scarce resources, so we gotta get smarter about that. And so I've got this kind of great quote that Governor Leavitt from Utah, former Secretary of Health and Human Services, he actually spoke at one of our conferences, and he said, we must reconcile our healthcare system built on the model of compassion with the dispassion of the global economic crisis. And that's really, I think, what this is all about, is we're trying to solve this from a, you know, from a fiscal standpoint, but still making sure we got the best healthcare system in the world. So my last kind of piece here, what does need fixing in Obamacare? And again, the most important thing, I think, is folks come back together, both sides come to the table and make these tweaks to get it right. Give the states more Medicaid flexibility. Again, a lot of states are innovating with the Medicaid expansion, trying to put folks in the private market. Get the benefit design right. We've got to get the cost sharing right. You've seen lots of horror stories about the premium levels and then just the level of the high deductible copays that are out there. That may require more subsidies, so you might need to cut providers more to get there. But the cost sharing, the benefit design is what really drives appropriate utilization of healthcare. Tweak the insurance reforms. One of the things that my colleagues in the insurance industry tell me, and a lot of these spikes you're seeing right now, is there's still cherry picking going on out in the market between the carriers. So we still haven't gotten the risk pools as big as they need to be, and there's not necessarily enough money in to pay for all of the health care. The other issue you have, if you've got folks that have not had insurance for a long time, you give them insurance, there might be some pent-up demand, things that they have not sought care for, and so they're going to be higher utilizers of health care initially. So we've got to get past that initial surge. We got to continue to focus on making healthcare more affordable. Again, I say that as a provider. I mean, we've got to do our part to manage down the cost as well. And again, I think a lot of those payment reforms will do that. Tackle rising prescription drug prices. I don't necessarily want to throw aspersions at another part of the industry, but I think there's plenty of data that's come out later. The Medicare trustees just released their report and said really what's driving cost increases in Medicare right now are cost increases in pharmaceuticals. You've certainly seen the stories about some of the bad actors that are out there. But again, you know, everybody else, this whole exercise is kind of shared pain. You know, one sector of the industry should not have to share in that, I would argue. And we've got to address coverage for undocumented immigrants. I mean, unfortunately, you know, because of political reasons, they were not included in this bill. Even California is seeking a waiver to allow undocumented immigrants to purchase insurance in the exchange if they choose to pay for it. You know, those folks are here providing services, paying taxes, paying sales tax and otherwise. I can tell you from my hospital operators, They're not languishing in hospital ERs. They can't qualify for Medicaid. You know, they're trying to work. A lot of them are sending money home. They want to get as well as quick as possible. But we ought to figure out a way for them to play in this game as well, and not just turn the other out. So that's kind of my prepared remarks, and I'll be glad to answer any questions or.
Thank you, John. Before we ask a question, I want you to speak to the state of Texas has refused to expand Medicaid. Do you agree with that? Does it hurt Shannon Hospital? Does it hurt Community Hospital, period?
Yeah, so again, so if you look at what's going on in Texas, there's, before the Affordable Care Act, there's about 5.5 million uninsured in the state. So about 1.2 million of those folks actually did the right thing and got insurance on the marketplace, the federal marketplace. So about another 1.2 million could be covered if the state expanded Medicaid. So yes, that's part of that 5.5 billion in uncompensated care that gets shifted onto the private market. And the reality is your local hospitals are taking those payment cuts, have been since 2011, to help finance this coverage expansion. Great that they're getting some of that covered through marketplace coverage, but all of those, they're taking cuts on the Medicaid side, and since we didn't expand Medicaid, we're in effect doubling up the cost share because we're taking the cuts and we can't cover those folks. Now, I recognize the frustration of the legislature about the Medicaid program and the fact that it is an entitlement. Folks generally aren't paying anything out of pocket. It has a fairly rich benefit structure. When you look at private market health insurance, it covers vision and dental, for example. So it's a state federal match, so we have to put up, in this case, 5 cents to get to get 95 from the federal government. But still, that 5 cents in the state budget, when you're trying to fix school finance, you're trying to deal with water, transportation, those other things, competes for resources. So they are frustrated with the rigidity of the Medicaid program. But other states, including Arkansas, which we used to joke about Arkansas, have figured out a way to get around that. Basically, they went to the federal government and said, we don't want to do entitlement expansion. We still want to cover these folks because it makes sense fiscally, it makes sense clinically, it makes sense, you know, morally, but we want to put them in the private market with everybody else. We realize we're going to have to subsidize 95% of the premium just because of their wage level. But that's a better system for them because at least they've got some skin in the game, even if it's a $5 copay. It's better for providers because those are private market rates that we negotiate with the health plans as opposed to the state, which is reimbursing us below cost. So it is a bad decision fiscally. It's a bad decision clinically. And it's also a bad decision because other states have shown us there's an alternative.
Okay. The way this microphone tends to work is, if I leave it on, it, you go in and out. So I'll take it to whoever's asking the first question. That you ask the question, then I'll cut it off and you answer the question because it doesn't work good. So, question? Yes, young lady.
There you go. Now, in the near future, do you foresee an expansion of the Medicaid for people like me who make around $5,000 a year? And you are right. If I had had my kidney cancer during the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, yes, I would have gone through all of the protocols. But since I was uninsured at the time, no chemo, no radiation, here by the grace of God. So someone like me has her boyfriend paying for the premiums and for the deductible and, you know, make sure the out-of-pocket is there because it's pretty high. Last year, I had to spend out about $6,000 out-of-pocket before the insurance kicked in, which, thank goodness, I went to MD Anderson because they wanted all that money just to do my biopsies, and I still need future biopsies. But my question, so I won't go on too long, is do you ever foresee an expansion of Medicaid for people like me?
Yeah, the answer is yes. I mean, because the fiscal reality of what we currently have is not sustainable. I think, Lance, we've got the we actually estimate, so that $5.5 billion in uncompensated care right now is going to be closer to $8.8 billion in about 5 years. So from a hospital system standpoint, you know, we can't continue to provide that care to uninsured individuals. So,
I never got any care that I didn't pay for. When my mother was praying for me to go to the ER and said, let's just go into debt, I would say no. So like right. I said, I'm here by the prison.
And that's great.
I didn't get any care that I had before.
So that's great, but the other side of that I would argue is, again, we're much better putting you in a system where you can easily get primary and preventive care, diagnostic care, than waiting until your condition gets worse. So again, maybe a little bit hopeful, but at some point, I think we're gonna have to set the politics aside and just say, it makes sense to figure out a way to provide folks coverage. And I think you've told a great story. One of the challenges we have in Austin is, you know, folks think we're talking about, you know, deadbeats, that we're just trying to cover under entitlement program. What this expansion population is it's generally folks that have one, two, three jobs. They're just at a wage level where they're not ever going to be able to afford insurance in the private market without a very deep subsidy. So that's part of the story as well, is just, you know, telling legislators that we're just trying to give folks a hand up, basically, here, and get them into a better system.
That's certainly true. In the construction industry, most of those folks make $14, $16 an hour. They work hard. They can't afford health insurance. But they're not deadbeats by any stretch. Other questions? Let's see a hand. Yes, ma'am.
What about people who don't have jobs and can't afford to get insurance and can't be covered? And in one case, for my son, he just graduated from college and he is no longer under my insurance, so it left him out. And I'm just wondering what could happen on that. And also, there's an aunt that's moving from California. How does that work for her, being 91 years old? How would it work?
So if you're elderly, you should be in the Medicare system. But for folks that are uninsured and you know, don't have a job for whatever reason, I mean, we're always going to have some safety net system for those folks. And again, you know, we've made that decision as a country that we're going to provide that safety net. Public hospitals, you know, their taxing authority it exists because they are generally the safety net system in a community. If you're a not-for-profit hospital like Shannon, you have a state law that requires you to provide some level of charity care. So I would argue we're always going to have some type of a safety net system. The question is just, you want to build that where you folks have access to primary preventive care and don't necessarily have to always seek care in a hospital ER, because that's problematic because they're probably sicker when they seek that care, and that's a more expensive care setting, so that costs the system more money.
I'm going to ask a question and then get back. I heard Ted Cruz say several times Obamacare is the biggest job-killing legislation ever passed in America. Is there any truth to that?
Well, I mean, again, your story, it obviously is a fiscal challenge to both businesses and individuals. And a lot of it's because we're, again, trying to true up the real cost of healthcare, because we haven't really had a system where folks have necessarily paid fair share in the right word, but having a system that's tied to employment and was great when everybody works for a large employer. It doesn't work so well in a system, you know, where you've got a lot of small businesses that are dealing with global competitors.
Okay.
So, you know, yeah, it's easy to argue that side of it, but again, that's why we have to have system reform. That's why I would look really hard at one of the things the Republicans have put out there is potentially de-linking the tax benefit from employer care. I think that's perfectly legitimate. If we could, again, we incentivize a lot of things in the tax code. If we could get that right and make that benefit more affordable, that would help employers because it would move that tab off of them onto the employee. And again, we would need to subsidize that at some level to make it affordable for the employee. So yeah, I guess for some businesses and in some areas, it is a competitive challenge. But we still need to fix it because the bigger job killer is that $8,500 per capita that we're spending on healthcare when Europe's spending $4,300. That's the job
killer. So has Obamacare saved healthcare money?
It absolutely has. You know, but again, the problem is it's all been through direct provider cuts right now, which is fine. That's one way to get there. What we need to continue to work on is the payment reform that I talked about, where providers actually work amongst themselves to lower the cost of care. So you know, those things have to happen. And then the third thing, obviously, is people need to make better decisions about utilization of healthcare. So,
all right, another question. Yes, Suzanne.
Do you think we would have been better off to have had maybe the single payer option, maybe a plan more like what Canada has? I know a lot of people say, oh, the Canadians don't like their healthcare system, but I have Norwegian relatives that live in Canada and they like it very well.
Single payer system is heard talked about a lot.
Yeah. So I'm going to answer that a couple different ways. So it's hard to get the single payer with the current system we have because, again, we haven't made all those other reforms. And so when you actually try to cost that out, it's a big number. And I think what Sanders has talked about when you read a lot of the independent economists, it is definitely a budget buster because you have to have all these other things to go along with it. What I see that works in other countries, and particularly European, is that, again, it goes back to this benefit design. I mean, basically what they do is they guarantee some level of safety net care. But then if you want to buy supplemental coverage, for example, to not have to have a shared room but a private room, it's just like buying an automobile. You can get the cloth seats, or you can get the XLT with fancy wheels and all that. So basically what they've done is guaranteed some basic level of care and then allow people to add on to that as they see fit. And I think that again works pretty well. That has lots of consumer satisfaction, obviously, because people can choose kind of what level of care they want. But that financially, one of the problems we have is we pretty much, guarantee everybody the Cadillac level of care, but we don't necessarily have a payment system to back that up. But again, it's hard to move to those systems after you've kind of seen it one way. The bigger argument, I think, for a single payer type of a system is, and I've got a slide, it comes out real good if we had a projector, just is the administrative complexity that we have in our current system. If you got any folks that work in a doctor's office or a provider office, horror stories about, they may have five physicians, but they got 15 people in the back office because they've got to bill Medicaid, Medicare, and maybe 12 different private health insurers, and each of those 12 health insurers has 15 different plans. And y'all dealt with that, I'm sure. They're looking at your card trying to figure out, do you have the gold or the this or the whatever. And so the amount of money we spend on administrative costs in the current system is brutal. And again, that's money that's not going to patient care or back into your pocket from a rate for your center.
Okay. See if anybody else has one before I come back to you. Any other questions? Okay. Like follow up
You mentioned a safety net. Right now, if my boyfriend stops paying for the premiums, I'm not required to have insurance because, like I said, make about $5,000 a year. What is the safety net there? It's just have no insurance and come up with the $50,000 for this, the $200 for a 30-day supply of that, $80 for a 30-day supply of this. So what is this safety net that you spoke of?
I think the safety net is if you go to the hospital, they're going to treat you.
They'll stabilize you, but that's it.
I'll let John answer.
Are stable in the DC because I've been in those situations.
Yeah.
And you get sick at home, and you're like, well, they'll just stabilize me again, and I'll return home and get sick again.
Yeah. So again, that, I mean, it's not ideal. I mean, that's why we would rather, you know, build a system where folks have some type of coverage. Well, it's just like it's EMTALA. It basically is just the law that requires a hospital to stabilize you. But there are, you know, in some communities, there are federally qualified health centers. There are community clinics. And, you know, in a lot of the larger counties where you do have a public hospital, they have a pretty extensive clinic system that they operate that helps. But, you know, that's a more of a challenge in a rural area.
Yeah, $5,000 a year is considered too rich. You need to make $2,000 at least to get a lot of benefits. And so I'm always in a conundrum because there was no way I could pull $300,000 out for a couple of months of chemo. There was no way I could pull $200,000 out for a couple of months of radiation. So people like me, we just have to pray, and that's what we have. And that's a good thing, prayer, because I'm here, but it's really frustrating people wanting to take away the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. You know, even if somebody adopts me and says, I'll give you a new kidney, you know, still I have to use rejection, anti-rejection drugs. If we get rid of Affordable Care Act, you know, I'm going to be groveling and praying.
I personally think the Affordable Care Act is as much here to stay as Social Security in the long run. I think it will get tweaked. I don't think it will ever get done. It's that historic a piece of legislation. What I hear John saying, and I think it's important for everybody to hear, is what politics should be about is finding the best win-win-win situations you can find for everyone involved. I don't know how many of you ever heard of Reinhold Niebuhr, but he was my favorite theologian, and he said we all act out of our self-interest. So you've got to sit down doctors, you've got to sit down hospitals, you've got to sit down pharmaceutical companies, you've got to sit down folks that are looking out for the poor and the health care provider, and everybody looks for, okay, how do we got to do this because it's the right moral thing to do. And our country believes that. We are that kind of country. But it's not fair to say the hospital is going to bear all the burden, or the doctors are going to bear all the burden, or it's how do we share the burden in a way that creates more effectiveness? And again, that's the kind of questions. And what happens when you get a partisan, so much partisanship in our country, we don't ask those questions anymore. We just ask, as Senator McConnell said, how do I make sure Barack Obama is a one-term president? Once you ask that question, you stop being an effective representative for your country. Because that's not the issue. The issue is, how do we help people live life better? And nobody does more than our hospitals and doctors. It's just like public education, folks. You lose public education, you lose all of our small towns. You lose all our communities. So we got to ask those kinds of questions. And John's one of those people trying to get people to sit down and work stuff out. And so I appreciate him coming and doing that. We have a question here. Yes, young lady.
Loud.
Okay.
Hi, okay.
Yeah, not like your personality because you're sweet. Aggressive like mine. Okay. There you go.
You were talking about sharing costs and things like that, a lot of it being community involvement, church involvement, DHS, social service, school, education, pharmaceuticals, issuing out immunizations and things like that. There are, I mean, efforts, USDA, to stir that up a little bit more, where those neighborhood health clinics and things like that, where it takes the cost out of the ER and things like that. I don't know if that would help, but I mean, I know school nurses and, you know, are very burdened as well, but that seems like one place to start. It would take it out of Medicaid, you'd have USDA and other programs picking that up as well.
Yeah. No. And again, you know, a lot of the payment reform that I talked about is really forces money out of acute care hospital settings into either outpatient settings or community-based settings. So when you create those incentives up in the payment system, it will force us to, and we already are doing it, look for partners in the community that can do it better than we can. And so that's going to be, just like you said, could be school-based, could be community-based, shelters, behavioral health. You know, that's when you look at hospital readmissions, a lot of those readmissions are because you're discharging folks into the community and there are not appropriate behavioral health services. So guess what? They either end up in the jail or in hospital ERs, neither of which are equipped to adequately deal with them. So again, I'll go back to that kind of that argument about payment reform of when you create more of an integrated model, it's going to force providers to look at those community-based partners to provide that care. Because what they find is that's going to be lower cost and it's going to be better quality, and they'll get rewarded for that. So
would that be like a La Esperanza clinics that we have here?
Yeah, exactly. Because what you're going to try to do is, again, in this shared savings model, if you can say I can, through primary and preventive care in a clinic, I can reduce all these expensive hospitalizations, then I'm going to be able to share in that saving. It's going to be better for everybody along the continuum. Same with discharge plans. When we, you know, discharge folks after a hospital stay, now because of readmission penalties, we're going to do a better job working with home health, with pharmacy compliance, with rehab facilities, you know, to make sure they get the care that they need. You know, technology can help too. You know, everybody's got a smartphone now. You know, you can track pharmaceutical compliance. You know, I think now there's even testing. You know, for diet, blood testing and things of that nature that can be done. And that's going to help too.
I was just going to say one additional way would be the Attorney General to find the dads to pay so the babies aren't on Medicaid.
Yeah, I mean, it's an integrated system, obviously. I mean, you've got to, you know, child support is important, you know, all of that. Making sure you got the resources given to the right place.
So do we know what Big Pharma and the insurance industry will tolerate in terms of change? Do you know what they will allow? Because they seem to have been pretty effective in shutting down before.
Yeah, you know, I think from the hospital perspective, what, you know, kind of scares us to death is there's been a couple times in our past, I was too young to remember, but when we were dealing with, you know, some of these global fiscal issues, and we actually had price controls in Medicare. It was actually, I think, under Carter once and maybe even under Reagan, because of these budget reconciliation acts where we were having to meet, you know, federal budget targets because of things that were going on in our economy and worldwide. And so at some point, people run out of money to pay for this stuff, and you get something arbitrary like that that's worse than you trying to re-engineer the system on your own accord. So, you know, I think it's short-sighted because, again, you know, I've talked about the cost trends. I've got graphs on them. You know, it's not a sustainable system, and you can't just continue to talk about, well, we're doing this so we can invest in the best in the best thing available.
So who financed the outrage and resistance to the Affordable Care Act?
You know, most of the providers, I think, were all in. And again, that's where I think Daschle did a really good job of figuring out where everybody had some skin in the game. Maybe pharma had less skin in the game than the rest of folks. The device manufacturers kind of pushed back against the device tax that was in there. That was part of their pay for. But I think more of it was, again, like you said, it was a political calculus that said, hey, this thing is very big and very complicated. It's so easy to take one little piece out of this, one little horror story, and try to bring the whole thing down, that was a problem. And on the president's side of the aisle, you know, they didn't do a good job necessarily of going out and explaining it either. But again, that's because it's so complicated. I mean, there's like, you know, five guys that really know how it works. Max Baucus was one of them, and he's ambassador to China now. So, you know, we lost, you know, Ted Kennedy, who was kind of all in on this deal. Kennedy and Orrin Hatch had a really good across the aisle relationship in Senate finance. So it's just, you know, some weird stuff happened, you know, timing wise in politics that were unfortunate.
I think by and large, the hospitals have supported it from day one, because the more that are insured, the less out of pocket expenses they have, correct?
Right. Yeah.
So hospitals have supported it. I don't know about doctors. Does it cost doctors money?
Well, so the problem the doctors had was, so they had this whole separate issue you might have heard about called the SGR, the doc fix. So this was, again, back under Reagan in the BBA, we created this automatic payment cut for physicians. And it was to ramp up over time. And so what Congress did is they basically, because it was arbitrary, they went in and passed a temporary hold on that every 6, 9, 12 months. So that got to where that was going to be a 27% reduction in physician payments in Medicare. And that's, again, where if you've had problems with new physicians seeing Medicare, the SGR was part of that. They were scared to death of that. So, fair criticism, Obamacare did not fix the SGR. So when I talked about everybody that had skin in the game, you know, doctors, hospitals, pharma, device guys, nursing homes, everybody except the docs, because they didn't fix the SGR. So that's another kind of structural problem, is that we couldn't necessarily get the docs to come along from the messaging standpoint, because they had this other huge fiscal cliff that they were worried about, plus just the uncertainty of this law. Now, that is since, you know, credit Kevin Brady, our congressman from the Woodlands, they actually permanently fixed the SGR about 6 months ago, and even better.
Define that SGR.
That's that automatic pay. It was called the sustainable growth rate. Crazy, you know, they said we're a sustainable growth rate in Medicare, we're gonna put this automatic payment cut in place. And so they fixed that about 9 months ago, and they moved the Medicare payment system for doctors to more of a value-based payment system as well, which is good.
All right. That man had a wonderful voice, and we could all hear him. Thank you.
Some specialists don't seem to be available in the market for Obamacare. Is there a voluntary physician program for saying, yes, I will accept Obamacare, or is it every doctor must accept it?
So there's not to get too much in the weeds, so there's a network, supposedly a network adequacy requirement if you offer health insurance in the marketplace. The problem is, you know, that's not well-defined, and we're kind of in this limbo where we're, since the state didn't set up an exchange, we buy insurance off the federal exchange, but insurance is still regulated by our Department of Insurance. So there's a little bit of a disconnect there. I think there's some resource issues at TDI, so if there's a complaint about network adequacy, you know, they have, I think they've got a backlog on dealing with that. So I think part of it's a compliance issue, but part of it is this issue of just the newness of the system and making sure there's enough resources in those plans to actually pay specialists. And so you'll hear the term narrow networks. So a lot of these plans, because of the resources, the actuarial resources that are in the plan, they limit the number of specialists or doctors. They even limit, you know, hospitals. They certainly will limit specialty hospitals like an MD Anderson and some of the higher cost hospitals. So again, that's one of those fixes we need, is to figure out a way to improve the network adequacy on the specialty side. And I think part of it is enforcement, but part of it is that, just that truing up the actuarial soundness of those plans. So,
can some doctors refuse to accept Obamacare?
They can choose not to be in network with those health plans. But then it's the onus is on the health plans to go pitch them a better deal because they have to have an adequate network. So that's kind of the market forces that are at play.
Okay. Thank you. Other questions? Yes, sir.
What's the problem with looking around the world at a better health care system in Europe, for instance? Otto von Bismarck, previous to 1900, established the German health care system, and it's still operating.
And it works.
It works. And why can't the United States, whoever's involved in it, you and everybody else, go look at their system and see how it works?
Yeah, well, actually, I think we've looked at a lot of those systems, and certainly I think we're trying to take the best part out of each of those. The biggest problem is, you know, you got a system that's incrementally been built up over, you know, 50, 60 years, and it's just, you know, like kind of, you know, turning the Titanic. So, you know, a lot of it is going to be incremental change. But again, what we've tried to take from those systems is, you know, going back and looking at the benefit design. And those systems have, you know, more cost sharing. The cost sharing is such that folks are making better decisions about their utilization, about lifestyle, and otherwise. They pay providers differently, like I said. They typically guarantee some basic level of care and then allow people to buy up to a higher level of care. So I think we've taken some elements of that, but again, we still got to live with, you know, Medicare, the way that was created, Medicaid the way it was created, and the private market to some extent, which has been driven again, unfortunately, by employer-sponsored care, which was not necessarily the best way to build that system. But people started, you know, after World War II, because of wage suppression, employers started in competing for employees based on health benefits as opposed to wages, which is not
good. Well, part of what you always have is whoever's already got doesn't want to give up. And to fix things, whoever's got to give up some. And so that's just the nature of sin, folks. I mean, I hate to be a theologian on you, but I am one. And that's whoever's got never wants to give what they already got. So when you have the system already in place, changing the Titanic is a good example. It's hard to change because somebody that's got is going to get some taken away from them. And they're going to deal with it. If few more hands here. Go ahead, sir.
John, you've very well explained the complexity of this system, and I guess the question I have is, where are you most hopeful that we're going to get the leadership, the source of the leadership for providing the changes that you've identified? Where is that leadership coming from? Is it coming from Congress? Is it coming from the professional groups? Or what are the sources of leadership from your perspective that might help us move in the right direction?
Well, you know, that's a great question. I think, you know, probably the two areas that I look to is, I mean, one, it's got to continue to be the providers, because, you know, again, talking about pharma and insurance and whomever else, I mean, again, we have to recognize that the current system's not sustainable, and we have to continue to offer solutions about how to change the cost curve. But the, you know, the other piece is it's going to ultimately have to come from Congress. I mean, they're the ones that pass the law. And so, you know, again, I'm hopeful. For example, you know, looking at Speaker Ryan. I mean, Speaker Ryan was talking about entitlement reform, you know, before he became Speaker. You know, he's obviously got his own issues within his party. But, you know, the Republicans actually released a plan, I guess that was last week, Lance, where for the first time, you know, they kind of talk about, you know, a different way of doing things. You know, I'll give you an example. So one of the issues we deal with in insurance is the issue of pre-existing conditions. So one of the things the Republicans have said is, if we were going to do away with the pre-existing condition exclusion, one thing we could do is most states had a high risk pool before Obamacare, where you could seek coverage if you were denied coverage in the private market. The problem was, guess what? Those premiums were so high in those high risk pools, even if you tried to get coverage there, folks couldn't afford it. So what they've said is, if we're going to take that piece away, then we're going to have to provide funding to states for their high risk pools so they can subsidize those premiums. So maybe we should deal with folks with pre-existing conditions and high cost medical conditions in a separate pool, and that would make the rest of the market work better, because we're not trying to subsidize all those costs. So those are the kind of discussions we need to have going forward, and to their credit, they've put that on the table, where before it was, you know, buy insurance across state lines and, you know, stuff that wouldn't really even work.
Thank you, go green.
Okay. Most candidates,
most
presidential candidates on the Republican side said if they become president, they will do away with Obamacare, but on the first day. However, that's not what I wanted to talk about. I wanted to talk about pharmaceuticals. Actually, I am from Germany, and I can attest to what the gentleman said. They have coverage, and it works, and everybody is covered. And then I spent 20 years in the military as a dependent, and I was the recipient of military health care. And it works. It's not fancy. It's not extraordinary. You can't tell them what you want done. You can't tell them what kind of medicine you want. But it's effective. It works, you know, and I think they do it on a very small budget, because those clinics are not fancy or you know, you have to wait for appointments, but it works, and you end up not going to the doctor unless you really need to go, but it works. But I wanted to talk about pharmaceuticals. In this country, there are huge pharmaceutical commercials on TV, and people end up going to the doctor and say, I saw the so-and-so and I want to have some of that. Whereas I think it's the doctor's job
to prescribe your medication and not some ad on television. And that is why pharmaceuticals demand the prices that they do, because they know people will go in and ask for that medication. It's kind of, it defeats the purpose, I think.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, we, you know, again, we have to, I think, you know, look at doing things differently. And again, you know, most that would go, I guess, under what I talked about earlier. I mean, we need to do what makes sense clinically. And it's the physicians who are, by their training, are capable of doing that. And they need, I would argue, need to be left to their own devices to do that. And there's a lot of good work amongst themselves within each college, each specialty, where they focus on evidence-based care. And that includes the pharmacology, as well as lots of other different alternative types of therapy.
I'm not sure there shouldn't be a lot of reform related to pharmaceuticals. I'd also like to know why every one of those guys in those commercials is 63 years old like I am and don't know how to shave. Every one of them's got about four-day growth beard. Is that sexy now, and I missed it? If so, y'all need to tell me.
You may not be able to answer this one, but could you give any enlightenment on the amount of fraud and abuse that's in the two systems, both the provider and the recipient?
You know, I don't have a good number on that, but it is part of the equation, certainly. You know, and I think certainly the oversight agencies are continuing to look at that. But yeah, very clearly, you know, we've got, and again, that's, you know, the problem again with sometimes with an entitlement system is you actually create some incentives for folks to create companies and otherwise that overutilize those services. So, I mean, we gotta get smarter about how we manage that. But I think there's some bigger macro issues that are driving costs, but we, that certainly is part of it.
Okay, real quick, I've got two people who have asked questions before. I want to ask one more each, and so we'll do that, and then we'll shut her down because they like us out of here by 8:30.
Can you explain a statement? My daughter, she lives in the state of Alabama, and was applying for going to the marketplace to get health care. And she was looking for a subsidy, and they said she doesn't make enough money to receive a subsidy. And that sounded confusing. I didn't know if you could explain that, or if she said that right, or exactly how that worked.
So she's probably caught in that coverage gap because, again, Alabama was one of the states that didn't expand Medicaid. So basically, the way the law was set up is that if you earn between 138% and 400% of the federal poverty level, you qualify for a subsidy on a sliding scale. If you're below 138%, then you were to go into the state's Medicaid system. But for a state that didn't, like Alabama and Texas, that didn't expand Medicaid, then we've created a coverage gap. So if you earn between 0 and 138, you're left without coverage, basically.
138%.
Yeah, 138%. So I don't, you know. That.
Just a comment, he mentioned Alabama, Texas. Our comment on the great tragedies of America is that the states where the most people go to church do the least for education and health care and things like that.
Amen.
And that's embarrassing. Last question, young lady.
Okay, you've noticed that the insurance companies in this area are pushing people towards HMOs instead of PPOs. That means we have to go to our doctor to get referrals. Under the PPOs, you can go directly to your specialist. And that's really wonderful because it doesn't overtax the doctors with all these patients waiting on the phone saying, I need my referral. So since we are getting rid of the PPOs and the doctors are becoming overtaxed, wouldn't that make more providers want to say, let's pull back from this, we can't handle this surge of people needing referrals, you know, like somebody with me, like needing cancer, fibromyalgia, Sjogren's syndrome, asthma, allergy, sinuses, polycystic ovarian syndrome, like that. If I can just go to that doctor, go to that rheumatologist, you know, that makes it easier on the primary care, just sign the form so he gets the information later. But since the insurance companies here are pushing us all towards HMOs, don't you think that's going to make more providers say, I've had it?
Is that happening, or are they pushing?
No, they are, and again, that's a, again, an issue of, you know, we've got to get the, you know, we got to get that, the cost sharing, we got to get the resources in those plans right to where they can pay medical claims and not have to limit their network and do things about and move into more of an HMO model, because again, that's a way for them to basically control costs. So it all goes back to that issue of getting the risk pools right, getting enough money in those systems.
All right, folks. I'm really going to shut it down because it's there. Thank John for coming. This is sponsored by the Democratic Party. We also have a Democratic Club. There's two different organizations. Neither one of them ever has any money. So if you appreciate this, there's a little red bucket if you'd like to contribute a little bit to these events. The next one will be Social Security. Now, John, I'm going to argue with you on Social Security, and it's probably my Ted Cruz moment, but you know who Ken Griffin is? He's head of the Citadel hedge fund. He makes $100 million a month. That's his salary. So he finishes paying Social Security at 8:15 on January the 1st, because he's gone to 125,000. So I think we might ought to look at making a little older. I'd also like to see how much it would help if Ken Griffin paid a little more.
That's fair.
Is that fair enough? I mean, maybe Social Security up to the first 10 million and then just a handful of folks that make more than that a year or something before we take it all away just based on age. But that's why we're going to have this in a month from now. We're going to have a specialist that we can ask those questions to. I'm thinking Medicare and Medicare, as you said, are bigger issues that need reform than Social Security. And again, sometimes we do things because it's a great idea and it reflects our values, but then we haven't thought it through how it functions realistically. And if you're not willing to try to fix things and tweak them, that's just not smart. We all learn to do things better. I mean, I preach better than I could when I was 19, I promise y'all. So we all get a little better if we look at it. Thank y'all for coming. Clean up really good. Yes, ma'am?
When is the next day?
The next one is August the 4th. Be here. I'm out of here August 5th, Pittsburgh, baseball stadium number 27. Three to go after that. Thank y'all.
I put a handout on the table, too.
There's a handout on the table over there.
Thank you.